At this time, race 30 participants need to report to marshalling.
On a hot early summer day, we're at Rancy Creek Park on the shores of Lake Norman, located in Mecklenburg County's District 1. The park plays host to the 13th annual Charlotte Dragon Boat Festival. Vendor booths line the path to the water, stocked with all kinds of Asian vendors, from Chinese art to Vietnamese handmade goods to Indian street food and much more. Along the shoreline are more tents. These, however, are filled with competitors. Dragon boat racing dates back more than 2,000 years, originating in South China. To get an idea of what it looks like, picture a very long and relatively narrow canoe with 10 paddlers on each side, a person to steer in the back, and one to keep the beat in front for a total of 22 racers on each boat. This is what a race sounds like. Dragon Boat Festival founder John Chen talks about the history of the Dragon Boat Festival in Charlotte.
I'm from South China, so we are water people. I like water. I got swimming, boating, and then I said, well, what are the things that would really potentially be of value to the community? And it doesn't really take very long for me to think about Dragon Boat. Dragon Boat, you know, is part of the three major festivals in China annually. Chinese New Year, the Mid-Autumn Festival, they call it Mooncake Festival, and then it's a Double Fifth, that's this festival. Okay, they call Dragon Boat, or they call it Double Fifth Festival, hugely popular. Now, you know, you go to a festival, you watch, oh, that's great, you eat something, you know, that's tasty. But this is something that you say, you got to get into to do it, to enjoy. So it's cross-cultural, interactive event, and on top of that, you have, you know, a bunch of people not knowing each other. You sit side by side. I mean, it's hot weather. You're kind of sweaty and everything else. But it's a team building sport. Okay, and 20 people in a boat. To win, you have to synchronize. Okay, how do you synchronize with 20 people? That means what? You have to have one mind, one tempo. This is a part of team building exercise. So you look at the cultural part. You look at the interactive part. You look at meanings about building a team, whether or not you're talking about community, you're talking about corporation, this all kind of tied together.
Since the festival's inception in 2006, Chen said the event has influenced others to learn more about Chinese dragon boats.
When we launched our festival, it's the first in the Carolinas, both in South and North. Today, there are 11 or 12 those in North and South Carolina cities or towns, dragon boat festivals, out of which we have influenced them. We first started this event. We have 18 teams. This year, our target was set at 60 teams. Not only that, is every year there are teams coming back again, 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 but there are new teams also. That we have the neighborhood association teams, we have the Indian community teams with the Chinese, and Vietnamese didn't join this year, but we're high school, we're college, we have breast cancer survivor, but our focus really is to recruit the local community groups.
He says the funding the Dragon Boat Festival receives from public sources through the Arts and Science Council helps him provide services that are uncommon to events like his.
Steering the boat is very difficult, but we have somebody in our club that just, you know, focus on just training the steerers. So we are able to provide trainings to the community teams. No other, maybe two or three other cities, is capable of providing.
If funding from public sources weren't as readily available, Chen says that they couldn't provide as many of the services and amenities that make Dragon Boat Festival free and accessible to everyone in the community.
Asian Festival doesn't charge a visitor a penny. Okay, we don't charge them anything. Did you ride a bus in? How do you enjoy the stuff? The bus is great, right? You don't pay any charge, you know, parking fee, $6, right? Standard, right? $10? Get on the bus, maybe $2. We don't do any of those now. You're going to have to find ways to leverage that if we don't have, you know, this kind of support. It's more than that. It's not just the money. It's, to us, it's the recognition. Okay, you know, we got an event. We have a sponsor, Arts and Science Council. That's important to us.
Hi, my name is Banu Vallaleris. Thank you so much for taking the time to listen to this series of podcasts designed to inform and educate Mecklenburg County voters on the proposed quarter-cent sales tax to stabilize and transform the arts and cultural community and ensure cultural equity. On November 5th, you will have a chance to vote on this initiative, and listening to this podcast is one of the best ways you can make sure you're prepared when you fill out your ballot. If you're unfamiliar with the proposed sales tax, I recommend you stop listening to this podcast now and tune into the first episode in this series. It will give you a complete overview of the tax and more context to what we're going to be talking about today. In the Cultural Vision Plan, Charlotte Mecklenburg residents articulated what they wanted to see from the arts and culture sector to the Arts and Science Council. They said, "We envision a future in which opportunities to create, participate, be involved in, learn from, and enjoy arts and cultural expression will be more abundant than at any other time in our history. Culture will play a more intrinsic role in enlivening, engaging, and enriching all of Charlotte Mecklenburg's communities, helping to build strong bridges, increase dialogue, and understanding. Neighborhoods will nurture, support, and celebrate their authentic cultures and creative expression. Partnerships between cultural organizations and community entities, including churches, merchant and neighborhood associations, clubs, schools, and more, will increase shared ownership and become the catalyst for new and different neighborhood initiatives and projects. In this episode, we'll take a look at how arts and culture impact our community, enhance our sense of belonging, and allow us to make connections. We'll visit the home of Ms. Deborah and Lionel Wellington, who have found vigor and vibrancy through free community dance classes. We'll hear from several community leaders, including Reverend Dr. Ricky A. Woods of First Baptist Church West and Patsy Birkings of the Community Services Association, Maddie Marshall and residents of the Beatty's Fort Road Corridor, Daniel Valdez of Charlotte Pride, and more. Finally, we'll sit in on a Dapper Street Productions show and then speak with founder Nikki Canada. First, let's hear a story from historian Tom Hanchett.
I think the first year we had a couple hundred folks, 300, 400, 500 people showing up, having a soul food dinner together at the United House of Prayer for All People cafeteria, and then sitting next to each other, enjoying the music, standing up when it moves them. And one of the performers looked out at this room full of young and old and black and white, and he said, "This is what heaven's going to look like." Arts and culture are an ingratiating way to find out about folks who are not like yourself. And I have people all the time asking me, you know, I like Cuban food. Is there a good Cuban restaurant in Charlotte? Well, yes, there is. But this last weekend, that Cuban restaurant, in partnership with organizations and some that are funded by Arts and Science Council, put together a slam bang Cuban festival. And, you know, hundreds, maybe thousands of people there, a couple of national headline performers. And this was way down South Tryon in the Steel Creek area, which doesn't seem particularly international, doesn't seem particularly, you know, it's not a place you would look for cultural tradition. It's very newly developed. There certainly is an old cultural tradition there, but you know, all of this new stuff is swirling. And Arts and Science Council, arts and culture help us discover ourselves.
Cha, 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 left and right, left turn, right, left, right.
Here at the West Charlotte Recreation Center, located in Mecklenburg County's District 2, Demond Carter demonstrated the steps to a James Brown song to a group of seniors as part of a program Demond leads called Stepping Into Health.
Well, this morning we're going to do our soul line dance class at the West Charlotte Recreation Center. And we're hoping to have a lot of participants today, so we always have a good time. We always have good energy, so we're looking forward to it.
Most of the people participating in the program are seniors, and stepping into health allows them to stay fit and active thanks to funding through the Arts and Science Council's Culture Blocks program.
Well, most of the people that come to the day program are, I would say, our population that's over 55 years old, retire, have free time during the day, they want to get some extra exercise in, and also have a good time.
We spoke with a few of the participants to get an idea of why having access to programs like Stepping Into Health is so important.
It allows older seniors like myself, who will soon be 70, to dance. Mm-hmm. And dancing is the way that we communicate with our spirit and our soul, and allows us, it makes us smile, okay, and it makes us live longer too, yeah. You know, so, and it's a way we say, hey, how you doing? You know, things like that.
Right. I don't know the name of the song. What is it? Shake a Tail Feather. That's what it is. That's a pretty cool one. Easy Steps. So that is her okay. Favorite one. Shake a Tail Feather. Oh, yeah. Yes. That's her favorite one.
I've heard it said before that, you know, the visionaries and the thinkers are the cornerstones of our community, and the arts and the sciences, and those are resonant vehicles for us to express ourselves. And a lot of times we get caught up in the day-to-day activities of just taking medicine, paying bills, going to work, that we forget how to express ourselves. And offering a service like this where people can come out and be challenged to express themselves, maybe in an environment that they're not comfortable with, maybe in a medium that they're not comfortable with, but getting them to participate and then just release that energy that is in them, creative energy, and bring it out.
Given more funding through the quarter-cent sales tax, DeMond says that he could improve access to his program and serve a greater population of the county.
Well, first, it would allow us to expand and be able to provide the program in more facilities, be able to bring on more instructors so that we can have multiple classes, multiple days going on at the same time. So that not just isolated pockets of the community can benefit from it, but that a broader spectrum of people in the community across Mecklenburg County and hopefully beyond that could be able to come in and participate. Because of the restrictions on the funding right now and because of the blocks that we're restricted to work in, and the lack of facilities in some of those blocks, it makes it difficult to find partners that are willing to actually host a programming and be able to go into those communities that may not be on the bus line, communities that may not have transportation, communities where you have a higher geriatric population that wants to get out but doesn't have access to get out. And so it may be able to allow us to offer other services to actually get people to the programming.
We'll come back to Stepping Into Health in a minute, but first, let's go north to Highland Creek neighborhood, located in Mecklenburg County's District 1. We're going to take you inside the home of Miss Deborah Wellington and her husband, Lionel.
My name is Lionel Wellington.
My name is Deborah Wellington. I'm married to Lionel Wellington.
In 2014, a series of major health issues left Lionel very weak.
Well, he's been sick for 5 years. He's had a couple of heart attacks, a CABG, 3 stents. This last year, he had heart attack, pneumonia, bowel obstruction, everything. And they sent him home to die. They told me to take him home. They couldn't do nothing for him. The VA, and that they can only help him change his cathera. And I just took him home and he collapsed right here at my door. And I'm sorry, I get emotional. I rushed him to the hospital. I said, somebody help me help my husband live his best life. That's all I want. And they admitted him. And then they decided that he needed rehab. And they cleaned him out and they put him in rehab for 21 days.
It was during this time that Ms. Deborah found out about a program similar to Stepping Into Health called Dance Without Limits, also funded through the Arts and Science Council's Culture Blocks program.
Patrice and them came in and they said they had this dancing. I said, do they take men? And she said, yes, we do. Right? I said, okay, I'm bringing my husband. Right? And we did not miss nothing. And the whole thing is, when we got married, I said, promise me we'll go dancing when we retire once a month. And so he kept the promise. And that, it was wonderful. It was wonderful to see him move.
The benefit for Lionel has been tremendous. The increased activity has kept him moving, which helps with his overall health. For Ms. Deborah, it's easy to see the way her eyes light up when she talks about the quality of time she gets to spend with her husband. It's also clear that despite all he's been through, Lionel still hasn't lost his sense of humor.
What was it about the Dance Without Limits class that made you want to keep coming?
It made me move. I enjoyed it a lot.
Made you feel active? You learned some new dance moves?
They weren't new. I've been doing them for years. Thank the baby.
Yeah. Patrice Commodore, organizer of Dance Without Limits, talks about Lionel's time in the program.
So the Dance Without Limit class consists of a 12-week program broken down into four units. The four units cover cultural dances, social dances, dancing with props, and improv and choreography. And so we wanted to create a program that seniors would be excited about and where they could have a say in creating original choreographic works by collaborating with their fellow dancers. And so I started thinking most seniors, maybe they go and see art, but how often are they challenged to think creatively, to work on team building skills? A lot of those things, as they get older, they don't do. So I thought a program that incorporated improv would be great. It would challenge them. And jazz, yes, yes. So Mr. Lionel was actually our inspiration for jazz, because the other thing about this program, we took feedback. So we had an idea of what we wanted to teach, but going in, they would give us suggestions. And Mr. Lionel was the one who said, let's do jazz. Okay. She pulled my coattail and was like, you got to get some jazz in here for Mr. Lionel. And so Shonda and I, we went and we pulled out our notes and we incorporated some vintage jazz. So earlier he had mentioned Spanking a Baby. That's like a vintage jazz step. Picking cherries, eating cherries, Shim Sham. And so we just played around with that. We put them in groups and they created original works. And then they would also be the audience. So they could see what their classmates did as well. And so that was great because it inspired them to move and inspired them to communicate. Right, left, right, chop,
chop. Step left, in. Back at the West Charlotte Rec Center, Demond talks about why this type of work is personally gratifying for him.
You know, it's, you know, when you first start doing it, you really just think that you're just doing providing a service. You come in, it's fee for service, you get paid, you do your thing, and you go. But after the first 2 or 3 weeks, and you see how the people look forward to you coming, and they schedule their entire day around you being here, and they want to make sure that they're there and are participating. It gives you motivation to make sure, okay, I know someone is waiting on me. I have to get there because they're not just looking to participate in the activity. They're actually looking for me to be there and to be with them, encourage them. And the relationship that you build with all of these individuals goes beyond what we do just here at 11 o'clock on Tuesday morning, because they have my contact information. They're always reaching out, hey, can you do this? Can you come here? Can you do that? And being able to build those relationships, secure those bonds, and to have an impact on people's lives in this way is more beneficial than anything that I think I could do.
It's been a great, 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 great week. So thank you all for getting started with us today. Again, we appreciate you sacrificing your time. That is the only asset that you have, and you gave me an hour over today, and it is not going unnoticed. So thank you. All right, y'all. I'll see y'all next week. All right, come out tonight. 7 o'clock tonight if you want to come out for walk-on class. Yep, right here, 7 o'clock.
One of the themes that keeps appearing when we speak with community leaders like Reverend Woods is how arts and culture helps build bridges both within and across communities.
Well, for one, it causes people to come to parts of town that they might not normally come to be exposed to people that they may not be necessarily exposed to. It also gives them an opportunity to see that many of the same kinds of things that they value are important to them are important to others in the community that they don't know.
Daniel Valdez, president of the board of directors for Charlotte Pride. Our community is made up of all of us. And so if there are folks that are not being represented, then we're not really getting the full picture, right? Like as someone who's maybe, you know, if you are a longtime Charlottean or you're Caucasian, you're straight, you're Christian, whatever it may be, you see your story all the time, but you're missing out on so many other things. You're missing out the full story. And so I think that it's important for us to also think about not just the benefit of me seeing, you know, my story or my culture, my identity being represented, but that potentially what that could mean for other folks. I think that Charlotte Pride, the festival, for example, is a great platform to showcase local arts, our local artists, local queer artists, whether it's on the main stage, on the community stage, whether it's at our Flourish event, which is inside of the Beckler Museum. I think that the festival is just full of arts and culture, and it's a huge draw to our community. Our film festival is just another way as well of us being able to showcase stories, not just from our local community, but from all over the world through film, and to really create awareness and bridge building through that work. So I think that that our biggest events and programs are grounded in arts and culture because it's, I think, a very natural and intrinsic way of creating community, building bridges, and really being able to bring folks together and celebrate the diversity that exists in our community.
My name is Maddie Marshall. I serve as president of Historic Washington Heights. I think that's the beauty of the, as I say again, the love, peace, joy, and happiness that anyone will experience. As I say, my journey from the Georgia cotton fields to New York, I mean, I experienced more cultures than I could imagine, but it was transformational for me. And it will begin to get into a lot of the race relations and begin to have people truly deal with who they are and why they're here and the importance of this day matters. You could see someone from a Ballantyne coming to Washington Heights. I've never had the experience of anyone, you know, trying to look down on someone. There's an appreciation once we all get together. I think my blood is red too.
She saw a need to bring this program from the museum to a community that's right across the street.
At Greer Heights Presbyterian Church, located in Mecklenburg County's District 4, Ruby Britt Height leads an arts education program organized by the Mint Museum.
For the last 16 years, the Mint Museum has been engaged with the Greer Heights community, which is across the street from our oldest branch. We have two locations, Mint Museum Uptown and Mint Museum Randolph. And we are engaged with the Greer Heights community, which is close by, but also the art is able to engage this community, which traditionally would not be engaged with the Mint Museum.
The goal, Ruby says, is to use art to connect communities, build bridges, and instill a sense of identity.
What we found, and it was even an article that came out a few years ago about how major arteries in Charlotte and in other cities can actually divide communities. And so even though Greer Heights is right across the street from the Mint Museum, when we look at underserved and underrepresented audiences, this is one of those communities. And our decision was to create an arts program for the youth in this community to get them engaged and started early. So 16 years ago, we created a program and it's grown. We've had probably about 500 students altogether over the years who have gone through the program. And we use art as a springboard for conversation, for dialogue, for allowing them to share their thoughts, their concerns, their feelings, to grow them with self-confidence and self-respect and mutual respect, and to build their confidence in being from a community that has been known in the community as maybe marginalized and maybe one that they felt like they couldn't be proud of. It used to be called Greer Town, and it is named after the Greer family. And what we do is we instill in them African-American history, know who they are, whose they are, where they come from, and then we feel like they can continue to be great, engaged citizens in Charlotte.
To see the effects of the Greer Heights Community Youth Arts Program, we talked to the parents of a young boy participating.
Well, one, it gives him an extra day in the week to do something positive. Structure, and he loved coming out, hang with his friends, met some new friends, you know, got some school buddies that's here, and it's just different for him, you know, learning, taking it to the future with him. It's good for him and the children, you know, when they go, you know, grow up and they want to travel the world, they have a base already in you know, in motion. So as they see the stuff they're working on now, as they go and travel the world, you know, if possible, they'll know, okay, I remember this when I was a kid. You know, this was cool.
Also present is Delilah McDonald, a mental health counselor specializing in pediatric psychology.
I always deal with mental health. So with mental health, if your mind is healthy, you're able to venture out and do numerous of things. However, if you are not healthy mentally, it's hard to focus. It's hard to be alert. If your mind is somewhere else, you're worried about something that has happened. So getting your mind right in the sense of I'm able to come to a safe place, I'm able to share my feelings, and I'm able to enjoy the arts. And meaning sometimes this art is a coping skill for them. Sometimes this is something that, you know what, I can escape. I can write poetry about my feelings. I can draw, you know, or I can get lost in whatever is going on now to take my mind off of things that's going on in the community or going on in school.
Delilah says there is no investment too great to be made into the lives of these children.
There's not enough money you can pour into a program like this because they're here today. They're not on the streets. They're not home by themselves. They're with adults. We're sharing with them. This is a priceless program. You have people that have been in this community for X amount of years. It's one of those things where they know us. They feel safe with us. And for one day out of the week, they know that I have something that I can go to that's my program. You know, would you rather them be home alone? Would you rather them be in the streets? Would you rather them be in a gang? Or would you rather them be here learning art?
We talked to two students whose participation in the program helped them discover a love of fashion and design.
The coolest piece of artwork that we've seen was at the Mint Museum when we went to go see Nellie Ashford. She had this like jukebox, and then it was made out of like fabric from her childhood, and like she like made a painting out of her childhood.
Well, we made African prints fans. It's like art to me, and it's like I liked it because it's like if we are hot, we like to do our own fans.
A familiar theme that we heard with many of these community leaders is something that Ruby emphasized as well, and that is the importance of access.
One thing that we embrace in the art community is accessibility. We find that when students are exposed to the same kinds of opportunities, the same kinds of levels of education and textbooks and materials and support materials and experiences, then they have more of an equal playing field. There are privileges that some groups of people have that others don't have, and we find that in just in everyday life. That can transcend, but the more we can educate one another, the more we can use the funds to support the arts, use the art as a springboard for conversation, for dialogue, for developing new programs, for developing new opportunities for artists to use art as a way of expressing themselves, and then also be able to put more back into their life experiences in their communities and in the schools. Music is a big part of that. We find that music is very universal, and we use that a lot at the Mint Museum to be able to bring people together.
The woman with the sequence dress on is called the juke joint, so that was a piece of that. Then the family reunion, her memories, and that's a part of who we are as a culture. When we come together as families, we can look at where we come from, who we are, who our relatives are.
So you would see a deterioration in a lot of neighborhoods throughout. And I think where you see neighborhoods thriving and doing well, again, I'm going to say, is because of the arts. It's a way of strengthening people. It's a way of having people to endure, to rise above any challenge. So without that, a lot of people would be destined to fail. But with that, we all have an equal chance to be the best that we can be.
It's just that simple. The church is vital to what we do. It provides enormous in-kind support. But basically, we are funded through grants, donations, that type of thing. When it gets cut, it directly affects what we do and our ability to serve. Our numbers simply will go down, or the programming will be cut. It's just that simple.
Just north of uptown of the Sugar Creek Library, located in Mecklenburg County's District 3, Nikki Canada warms up the audience for a free community jazz show, courtesy of Dapper Street Productions, Canada's jazz, arts, performance, and education nonprofit.
My name's Sean Higgins. This is the third part in a three-part series of Sean Higgins Plays Herbie Hancock. We always are talking about as musicians how to raise the musical level in general. And if we don't give any music to these kids, that's a surefire way to make the music just go down the tubes. Because without trying to play an instrument, they have no standard for what's good or what's bad, you know? And so to us, that's our hope, is in these kids really trying to bring the music.
We talked to a couple in attendance about why they enjoyed attending Dapper Street's shows.
The talent has been wonderful. I mean, really amazing talent.
Just a relaxing evening. And jazz, you know, we've been here 13 years. I'm from Washington, D.C., and they didn't have any good jazz down here. But now it looks like the talent is all over. The first guy we saw, he played Art Blakey, and man, he was tough. He was real tough. We've been waiting for this. Yeah, we've been waiting for this. You know, there are a lot of jazz enthusiasts here in Charlotte, but there was just no venue that you could go to where you could hear good jazz. And I mean, the talent here has just been exceptional.
As for Nikki and where she got her love of jazz from?
Well, I grew up in a church. So, you know, when you grow up in a church, you just, that's mandatory. You sing in a choir. For me, it doesn't have any rules. There's no rules with jazz. I do what I want to, you know? I know that sounds, that's just what I love about jazz. There's no rules. To me, it's just like, I can express myself. However,
When it comes to providing more of the art form she loves, Nikki says that access is her biggest priority.
First of all, I'll say that everybody can't afford a $20, $30 ticket to go uptown to hear great musicians. And you have a lot of people that don't have cars. Being out here in, you know, just on the scene as far as the arts is concerned, there are a lot of people just like these particular events, they don't have cars. You have a lot of the senior citizens that are on fixed budgets. They can't afford to get into these events. So everybody doesn't go uptown. So to be able to have these events at the libraries and at the parks and at the rec centers, the number of people that actually come out. When I first started, just even at the rec centers and stuff, there would be 5 people coming to the shows. Now we're packing it out at 100. So people are really taking to having the intimate shows within the community versus uptown. So, you know, it's...
One of the biggest factors in allowing Deborah Street to grow its audience and better serve the community is through the Arts and Science Council's Culture Blocks program and public funding.
But also, you know, the partnership that I've had with through the funding from Mecklenburg County, it has allowed me to expand because I have a better marketing budget to be able to reach, you know, a better reach. And so the partnership has helped my company grow. So, but let's not get it twisted. Dapper Street, we get out here and we bust our cheeks. You know, we put in a lot of work. So it's just a great partnership.
Ultimately, for Nikki, it comes down to giving more access to the arts to more people in the community.
To me, access is very important. Again, the arts is not just for those with expendable income that can go uptown and enjoy it every night or on the weekends. The arts is for everyone. And I think we need to make it accessible to everyone. And with the funding that's coming through Culture Blocks, we're making that happen because we're bringing it into the communities, you know. And I for the last 2 years that I partnered with them, I see the change. We started off with 5 people when we started with Culture Blocks. Now I do a Color of Jazz music series. They're coming in at 120-some people every month. So that tells me that that this program that's being funded through Mecklenburg County is making an impact, and I would like to see it continue.
Thank you for listening to this podcast. If you've listened this far, then you're someone who is invested in helping our community make this important decision. No matter how you feel about the tax, I encourage you to talk to your friends, neighbors, and county commissioner. Finally, I ask that you take this knowledge with you as you vote on November 5th. As a voter in Mecklenburg County, this decision is in your hands. Please remember to listen to the other episodes in this series on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. Subscribe for free, and you'll get the second season of this podcast featuring more in-depth information about the tax to be released closer to the voting time. Don't forget to submit a rating and a review, or just share this podcast with someone else you know who cares about the future of our community. Want your voice to be heard on this subject? Here's how you can share your thoughts about the proposed sales tax. Text or call 704-286-6288 to share your thoughts. That's 704-286-6288. If you call, you'll go straight to voicemail and can leave a 30-second message. Or you can send an email to asc@artsandscience.org. Your responses may be used in a future episode of this podcast. This podcast was produced by the Arts and Science Council and Gojo Studios. Writing, field recording, editing, and mixing by Andy Gow. Additional research and support provided by Krista Terrell, Bernie Petit, Lillian Parker, and Giovanna Torres. Original music by Harvey Cummings. I am Banu Valladares. Thank you again for listening. Gracias por escuchar.